You might ask if all of this is a prank, the existence is a prank, which it is. It is spirit simply playing a prank on itself. What do we do? What do we do? Well, we actually need to listen to high spiritual discourse, and examples of holiness. That's what we need to do. The continuity fear makes fools of us all. So even though this is all a prank, the continuity fear makes us keep believing in this prank, which is utter nonsense. So instead of believing in the prank, listen to high spiritual discourse and true examples of holiness, especially contemporary examples, if you can find them. They're pretty difficult to find right now, to say the least. So high spiritual discourse is what we have to do. There's no way around it. It's how we finally feel that we have a soft enough landing for us out of this prank. We're so pranked ourselves so bad that, you know, we almost believed it. We tried to believe it, and we realize now belief is nothing. Belief is nothing. Will is everything. Belief is nothing. But we're so used to belief, we need to believe in something that orients us back to the recognition that belief is actually nothing at all. Nothing. No power to belief. No power to imagination. Only God's will. God's will is the only power and authority there is. And we are an extension of God's will. What we tried to do is we tried to create a separate will. And we tried to give birth to it. And tried to nurture it. And tried to learn to value it and all this. This is all just belief. It's all a prank we're playing on ourselves. A joke, prank. Something that an adolescent does out of whimsicality. But we have this, you know, long association with believing that belief has some power. Now, the problem in the world right now is that coma is being made fashionable. I mean, going into a coma of belief is being made fashionable. High spiritual discourse sort of extricates us from belief, actually. It does. We have only one issue. We're either in one or two camps. Either we accept God's gift to us of holiness, the vision of holiness, actually, or we don't accept it. There's only two camps there are. There is nothing else going on. What those who reject it say, well, first we have to establish a separate will, and then that separate will decide whether to accept it or not. Okay, this is delusion. This is the prank we're playing. And, you know, almost everyone is in that camp still. So there's a lot of peer pressure to remain in that camp. Too much peer pressure. And so coma, the coma of delusion is being made super fashionable in this world, which is a very big problem and concern. Maybe too fashionable for me, for anybody, actually. Now, I saw the future in a dream last night, the near future, and I saw what happened. Foresight is interesting, what happens with time. First, you're shown what happens without foresight. And for me, what happened was I didn't make it, I failed. But with this foresight, this is what is going to happen if you don't have foresight. Now I say, well, I do have foresight. Therefore, I can change the outcome of how I respond to the situation. There is going to be a conflict. I was driving along the highway. This is how it's symbolized. And I saw these two cars off the side of the road. And it seemed like these two cars were smashing into each other. And I said, wow. There's some severe belligerence here, and this is going to be a conflict. And I saw that two people, drivers, get out of the car, their cars, and I realized, oh, I could tell that each one thought they were in the right, and they'd somehow gotten tangled up, and one was a Porsche, a Porsche, and the other was, I'm not sure what, I couldn't tell what kind of car it was. But there is a very nasty conflict. Now, I saw all these cars pull over the side of the road, and people realize, uh-oh, you know, here, this is a, we need to jump out and see if we can intervene or what we can do. And I kept driving, I kept driving. I said, no, let it be, let it be. And I saw a lot of other cars driving towards it. I said, wow, they're probably going to stop too. And finally, the overall, the fact that I felt everybody was stopping, I said, you know what, I need to pull over and stop too. And then, so I stopped and I walked all the way back. And indeed, there was this horrible fight going on between these two belligerents. And people were trying to intervene and stop them, and they'd pull them back for a while, and then they'd start again, and they'd pull them back for a while, and then they'd start again. And this went on and on and on and on and on. The fight just went on and on and on. It was terrible. And of course, everybody was trying to intervene, but they couldn't stop it. The belligerents were so angry at one another. They'd cool them off, supposedly, for a little while, and then they'd go at it again. And so finally, it finally cooled down to the point where there wasn't, you know, just this over a war taking place. And then I wandered back into some canyon to sightseeing, and there's some sort of a canyon with all these different colors, and I thought, wow, really neat rocks here. And I said, okay, let me see if I can, this could lead somewhere positive. And it turns out it was a dead end. There was no way to get out of that canyon. And I realized the whole thing was just a waste of time, totally waste of my time. And so I spent all morning working on this and how to use this foresight to choose right now a better path, a better avenue, how to avoid this whole situation. Because the peer pressure is what got to me. And this is something I think that we overlook, is I didn't want to stop, but I said, wow, if I don't stop, I'm going to stick out like a sore thumb here. And it was just a horrible situation. So there's going to be a long, long conflict going on in the world. And you know what this is about needs to be looked at. How to sidestep it, what do we do? I came up with several variants on how to sidestep, but there's a couple ways that I thought would work. The best one is simply to take a detour off the main road. Because if I keep going forward on the road, all these cars are streaming in. I realize that these are cars are being drawn in to this conflict. That they're subconsciously, they realize they're coming from a higher state, but they're saying, oh, there's a conflict here, and they're being attracted to it. Now, what this conflict really is just an advertisement for the belief in a separate will. That's all it is. It's like a flash mob advertisement. It is a commercial for separate will. That's all that it is. It's a complete waste of time. There is no separate will. We don't have a separate will. We have a projected will, but that's not a separate will. We thought will could become separate by projecting it and then pretending in that there's time and space giving us the opportunity to learn that it's separate, as if it's already separate, but we don't understand it. So we need all this time to come to understand the separate will. This is all a delusion. There is no separate will. Therefore, we don't, spending time to learn about it is a complete waste of time. Time is a waste of time. That is a fact. So, two options arose in this situation. Now, of course, this is talking about the world, that there is going to be this big advertising campaign for separate will in the world. And trying to bring peace to them actually pulls us into the feeling of this conflict. That's what I saw, is these belligerents. It's all a scripted thing. It's all scripted. It's an advertisement. This, what happens in the world is scripted on a certain level of our intelligence, and that of our spirit is scripting this. Our mind is scripting it. And these belligerents are actually actors, okay, in this script. And the purpose of these belligerents is to try and get people to stop them, to rush in and say, whoa, 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 come on, let's have peace here, let's have peace. But they're not able to stop them. The actors keep going at each other and tearing each other's hair out and choking each other and gouging each other and all this stuff. And the people are like, oh my God, this is so terrible. And meanwhile, all those who come to so-called stop it are actually being drawn into this feeling that there's this battle of wills taking place, okay? And so they're getting the flavor and the essence, and they're getting the advertisement. They're getting advertised to. They're getting punked. They're getting punked. They're getting pranked. It's a prank. These belligerents are actors. And just like in like professional wrestling, you see, you know, professional wrestling, you see these professional wrestlers, that's exactly what the whole thing is about. It's all scripted ahead of time. I used to watch professional wrestling and when I was younger, and you know what, I didn't know if it was fake or not. I thought it was real at first. Many people back then thought it was real. Now it's come out that it's scripted. Back then, there was total denial that it was scripted. And I examined it very carefully, and part of me said, you know what, this has to be fake. It has to be fake. But they're doing such a good job. They really are great actors. They really are. Because they are getting slammed. I mean, professional wrestling, they're taking a beating. They're really taking a beating. Of course, the blows are ways to make it sound like it's hitting. It's not really hitting. And pow, they react like it's hitting them. But when they're thrown and flipped and all, boom, yeah, their bodies are taking a beating. But so part of me said that, hey, maybe this is real. Another part of me said, no, this, come on, this can't be real. You know it's not real. Why? But it engrosses us. Conflict engrosses us because we think that maybe there is a battle of wills taking place. That's what intrigues us. So now I realize professional wrestling is a complete con, a complete scam. I don't watch it anymore. I haven't watched it for a long time. I just said, ah. This is just suckers. It's for suckers. It's suckering us in. But it's super popular. Super popular. Has been for a long time. A lot of the wrestlers die very young. Very young. They take an enormous beating. Take an enormous amount of pain medication. They're actors, though. They're actors. They're in on it. You see these two antagonists. One's evil, one's good. And you think they're trying to kill each other. But later on, you find out they're best buddies. I was like, what? Best buddies. Laughing and yucking it up. And this is actually what's taking place always in the world. The combatants in these terrible wars, these terrible conflicts, are actually best buddies. Best buddies. It's just a professional wrestling thing. It's actors. They're just actors who've been raised up to be actors. You see, we think we're giving birth. That we're spirit. I'm speaking to everyone as spirit. We are spirit. We're pranking ourselves just because we want to see if we can. How good can we do this? Just like someone who's super smart wants to just say, I wonder how smart I am. I wonder if I can convince myself that I'm stupid. That is what we're doing. We're so smart, we think maybe we have the capacity to convince ourselves we're totally stupid. Right? And the whole spiritual path is the realization that we cannot convince ourselves that we're totally stupid. We cannot, because our intelligence was given to us by God, and we didn't create our own intelligence, and it's not God's will that we think we're stupid. But stupidity, we're trying to make stupidity fashionable in this world, and we're going all in with this. All in. Like a 9.7 out of 10. I mean, it is this very, very high stupidity where we're going to fail to recognize. Now, what if these professional wrestlers, nobody came to see them because they say it's all fake. They're just actors. You're trying to sucker me into the belief in separate will. I know there is no separate will. I know I'm holy and I have no choice but to accept that I'm holy. And I'm totally holy, totally intelligent. I'm not stupid. Nobody would go see him. What would they do? They'd probably quit. They say, why should we beat each other up? Nobody's watching. But the more people watch, the more they get into the acting. So the right thing to do is just ignore it. No, ignore all conflict. And that's, it'll dissipate that way. Laugh, laugh about it, pay no attention. The great saints, the great gurus, they pay no attention to it. And they're just an overflowing with bliss and laughing all the time. Meanwhile, all this war is going on, paying no attention to it. Like they're completely unaware of it. And see, from their standpoint, they know that these are just actors. These are just friends play acting. And indeed, this is factual fact, that this is the attitude of gurus, having studied, having studied them. The guru says, World War II, the guru said, these are just friends, dear friends, just playing the silly game. You know, he said, what about all these killing? They're going to kill each other. She says, what are you talking about? These are dear friends playing a silly, silly game. What are you so upset about? And so maybe the actors will keep acting out of habit or whatever. They think, well, but the fact is that they won't pull anybody else into this delusion of separate will. So it'll just be ineffective, and then they'll lose interest. They'll lose interest. There's no audience. No, they'll lose interest. And they'll still be best buddies, actually. Beneath the surface, we're all best buddies. Beneath the surface. All this belligerency is an act. It's an act. But the problem is everybody in the world fails to laugh and takes it seriously. Like an audience in professional wrestling, you see that they're like totally into it. They believe it's all real. And I'm like going crazy. Total hate, you know, for the villain. It's like just screaming, rabid hate for the villain. It's like, oh my God, what are you doing to my hero? You know, the villain's beating up on their hero. And they're just like freaking out. This has been happening and happening and happening in the world forever. And we see now on our TVs watching these shows. And you just say, wow, look what our mind is capable, our belief is capable of. Delusion, hilarious delusion. But when a whole world takes it seriously, then you're in danger. Just like I got caught up in this professional wrestling, watching it, because I thought it was so entertaining. It really was. Unbelievably, the costumes, the looks, it's so hilariously campy and entertaining. It's like, oh my God, you know, what is this? You can get caught up in this conflict that's coming in the world. And when you see everybody else getting caught up in it too, then you think, say, well, I better watch also. And your will kind of just, you know, your continuity fear makes you think, well, maybe I do have a separate will. Maybe it's possible. And then you get caught up in that possibility. And then you're lost, or you're wasting time. You're wasting time. All time is a waste of time, except the time you spend in resolving the continuity problem. Accepting your holiness. Nobody has any choice but to accept their holiness. All this belief in a separate will, that somehow flesh has given birth to a separate will, is just a prank we're playing ourselves. The female-male body identity thing is just a prank. It's spirit trying to see if it can make itself stupid. And believe there's some, out of that stupidity is a separate will, like the will of stupidity. Spirit saying, no, there's some other will that wills that I be stupid, God, and I'm I dwell under that will. And then it says, now there's this fight between the will of stupidity and the will of intelligence, good and evil, right? And I've got to find out, I've got to help the good triumph over the evil will. This is a prank we're playing on ourselves. There is no separate will of stupidity. There is no separate will of evil. There is no battle of good and evil. That is our imagination. That is a prank we're playing on ourselves. And God knows this. Of course, we say, oh, God's all for this. God wants me to defeat the evil will. I need to, we say, yes, there's an evil will trying to make me stupid, and I've been under the spell, that, but I need to defeat this evil will. This is delusion. God is not saying we need to defeat any evil will. There is none. There isn't any. We are just playing a joke on ourselves. And God knows this. God knows this entirely. instead of you're just a, someone driving on the road, set yourself apart from that. You know, and have some kind of official vehicle with all these lights flashing, blinking, blink, blink, and you're like escorting something to a very important destination, like a heavy load or something, and you're involved in this very important business, so you can't stop. That's one way of doing it. At first, I thought of that. Like you're part of a, you know, procession, like a funeral procession or something. Not that, but we're in a procession, an official procession, very official, and so you're not required or expected to stop for this belligerency. This is one way to do it, and I thought, yeah, that's a good way. And then I thought of another way, which is just to, before you reach the belligerency, just take a side road, so you're, none of the other cars even see you. Because the problem is with the procession, still all the cars that are coming into this belligerency, they're seeing you, and they're saying, well, wait a minute, what's this? You're still going to be under a lot of pressure. Whereas if you take a detour prior to this belligerency, so you're not even pressured by all these cars pulling over the side of the road, jumping out and running over there. You know what's coming ahead of time. That's what foresight helps you. Just take a detour, side road, where you go off on a different road and you don't even see that belligerency at all. You don't have any cars coming into this belligerency. You're not pressured by it at all. No pressure. That's better, in my opinion. But where is the side road, is what I'm thinking. Now, obviously, if we're not looking for it, we won't see it. So, having been warned ahead of time of this belligerency, and having seen what will happen to me if I don't make a proper decision, I then am now looking to see, okay, well, where is this side road then? I need to find this side road. Otherwise, I'm left with having then to put on the Ritz as far as an official vehicle, really official, super official vehicle that has to reach a certain destination, you know, away from the belligerency, and hoping that the peer pressure then will not cause me to pull over at some point, which is risky. It's risky. It's a little bit, you know, it's not the safe way, to put it mildly. It's kind of like, what can you say? It's not the safe way at all. The other route is the safe way. This way is kind of like a show-off way, say, well, I can handle the pressure type of thing. Well, why even bring that into the equation, really? Who are you trying to impress? This is the idea. It's an impressive way. It's got some flair to it, you know. It's got some style and flair to it, which is, that's something that my mind would entertain, like, yeah, why not do it with some style? You know, and say, I don't have to, these cars can't pressure me, you know, that kind of thing. You know, that could be a way, I'm not ruling it out entirely, but I would prefer to take the sidestep it. Because there's something of the heroic to, you know, put up with the pressure, that kind of thing. And really, the heroic is a way of subjecting yourself to potential failure, actually. Because people will say, hey, why don't you stop the conflict, type of thing. Not realizing it's all a ruse. It's a ruse designed to sucker us. It's a sucker play. And this is what high spiritual discourse points out to people. It should. It should. And there's not enough of this in the world, actually. Thank God for Jesus, who has given a lot of high spiritual discourse, both in the past and in the present times, with A Course in Miracles. Very high spiritual discourse. Now, he's not saying everything that could be said. It's put in a book to get us started. A book gets us started. But we have to become in touch with the living waters of high spiritual discourse within us, so that we can you know, be in real time here and be aware of what's going on and get it and talk about it. But there's not a lot of high spiritual discourse taking place in the world, unfortunately. So maybe it's time to sidestep. It's more time for the sidestep move than the heroic move kind of thing. It's like I could drive a Rolls Royce along the road and people might say, oh, well, they can't pull over because they've got a Rolls Royce. But people might get real belligerent and say, hey, who do you think you are? You know, you should pull over too. In other words, you say, I'm on such an important mission here that I can't even, you know, I'm not, it's not acceptable to pull over the side of the road. Well, that may or may not work. Whereas if you sidestep it, definitely that works. It's a sure thing. It's a sure thing. So why not take the sure thing, is the question. Well, maybe people want to pressure you, and so they don't want you to take the sure thing. They want to see, like, maybe I can even pressure them to pull over, and that shows how good I am. You do not remember how smart you are. See, spirit needs to remember how intelligent and smart it really is, how blessed and holy it really is. You don't remember that by defeating evil. That actually is a complete sucker play. So you're only pointing out, you're only reinforcing how stupid you think you are, actually, by doing that. That's not the way. The way is to accept the vision of holiness right now. So all the sucker play of time, you sidestep it. That's how you remember that you're not stupid. You were just trying to make yourself stupid and you can't. That's the way. You sidestep time. Time is nothing but a sucker play. It's not, that's all it is. You have all the media now, just like flies who descend on any conflict and broadcast it throughout the world. And everybody gets so, you know, oh, I want to be a good person. I want to be good. That is a sucker play. And this is what I've been trying to point out to everyone. This is the delusion. The delusion is that there is a separate will. If there's a separate will, then there has to be the two wills, right? And these two wills must be, whether they're agreeing with one another or disagreeing with one another. The idea is that the way back to one will is to defeat a separate will, is the prank. That is the prank. Because it's the height of stupidity. It's how we try to prove that we can be stupid. The hero defeating evil, you know, that is stupidity. There isn't any second will. There is no threat to God's one will. There is no other will. Reality is not threatened. Truth is not threatened. It needs no defense. Truth needs no defense. Reality needs no defense. All our heroic efforts to defend it is the stupidity. So if you want to remember that it's not God's will that you keep pranking yourself forever this way, then you have to distance yourself from conflict. Because conflict seems to present an opportunity that doesn't really exist in reality, of defeating something. If there's only one will, what meaning does conflict or defeat have? It has no meaning at all. None. It's just engaging in foolish stupidity, which also has no meaning. So it's like the son is saying, I can't go back home until I prove to God what a hero I am and I defeated evil, you know, something. That's stupidity. That's the prank. There isn't any evil will to defeat. All actors. These all puppets that we're using. Best friends putting on this charade to try and, you know, convince us that such a thing is possible. so we can work on our learning, like work on trying to learn to love, value, and appreciate death. You know, this, that there's some other will that's bringing about death. No, it's all our pretending. We're just pretending to die. All of time is just a pretense. We've never died. It's all, time is a pretense. Nothing's ever happened. So sidestep time. How do we sidestep time? Vision of holiness, vision of oneness, vision of this holy oneness. And that is what actually works. You just have to laugh. You have to laugh at it. When you see what a complete pretense it is, you can't help but chuckle at it. So that option is there. And you just have to look at it and have to do a better job of looking at it. And so we're so used to driving along this main highway. We think it's the right highway, the highway of time. It's a highway to nowhere. It's just the highway of pranked stupidity is what it really is. So the so-called side road is actually the real road. It's the real road of remembering that there's only one will. Remembering that we can't be really stupid. We can't actually be stupid. There's nothing to be stupid about, actually. We've just been silly. We've just been whimsical, actually. It's not stupidity, it's whimsicality. We're misinterpreting it as stupidity. It's not, it's whimsicality. Once you see that these belligerents are actually best friends, it's all a show. You know, he's like, oh, we're just being whimsical. So what do we need time for? Time is only the time that what we're taking as we, because we believe in this stuff. We think we're learning something. We say, no, I need a little more time to learn. Reality doesn't need any time. There's no time in reality. Reality doesn't need any time to learn that it's real. So there is this way to sidestep it, which I've been working on for so long and continue to be working on it and have not yet got it. Because there's still these two options. I'm thinking, oh, which one do I do? You know, which one do I do? It's better to sidestep it, but you know, rather than to create a big old show of, rather than have a big old parade, everybody singing and dancing and parading in the opposite direction. I don't know. That's what I have to discern. I remember driving recently, I've gone right past some exits, I missed it. I said, how did I miss that? Wow, you get distracted, you miss the exit. You miss the road. And so we're all on this road right now. Everybody's on this road. And people are pulling their cars over and jumping out of their cars and running over to the conflict, meaning their attention is no longer on the road back home. Their attention is on this conflict, and people are pouring in from the other direction towards it, and they're going to pull over too. And so you have this very cleverly scripted situation going on. So we do have to ponder on the right action at this point, for sure. It's going to be a long conflict. multiple conflicts. This is not something that gets easily resolved. No way. I mean, I saw it. That's the advantage of foresight, which I've always had. It enables you to examine your options before the future arrives, so that you already know, okay, this is what I'm going to do. So don't think that this belligerency is going to be easily, quickly resolved, and you jump back in your car. No, it goes on and on and on and on and on, and becomes just this horrible scene of conflict. And you just get delayed so incredibly severely. But actually, I finally got home, and it was pitch dark. It was pitch dark. And I said, oh my God, I'm in trouble. You know, I mean, my family is going to be very upset at me. It's like, where in the world have you been? That kind of thing. I just felt really sheepish, you know, really bad. I said, wow. So you got to think about, quote unquote, your family, your spiritual family. Whether you can come home, you know, late at night, and you're explaining, you know, what happened, and they're not going to buy the explanation, you know. It's like, wow. You can feel sheepish. You may not go home at all. You feel so sheepish. So the question is there going to be some big revival where the real official parade, like going towards home, that it seems so upbeat and wonderful. People say, oh, I don't even want to pay attention to the conflict. That's what I was told was going to happen. That's what I was told will happen. But it doesn't seem to be shaping up that way. Doesn't seem to be taking place. And that may be itself a trick. I was told there's going to be a huge revival in the world that will turn people's attention away from conflict and realize it's all a farce, and they don't really want that. And it's going to be a wonderful, incredible, with troubadour, spiritual scene. It's just immense. But that should have gotten underway quite some time ago. I just don't see it happening. You know, that appealed to me. That appealed to me. The sidestepping thing didn't appeal to me in the past. Because I said, I've got all these talents. I need to show people, you know, they have all these talents, skills. But it most certainly puts you in a situation where potentially you could really, really have your head turned back towards the conflict. And they'd say, hey, you know, if you're so good at making us happy, you should go back to the conflict and help people out there. And the fact is that doesn't work. You end up then getting pulled into the whole thing. So this whole big spiritual revival thing could have just been a scam, part of the whole scam as well. That is possible. And the trouble again is like I'm saying, well, I've got so many talents. If I can use those talents in a positive way, it, you know, maybe that, you know, that will make me feel really happy too. You know, that will be the right thing to do. That's the hook on it. And if I just sidestep the whole thing, nobody will know how talented I am or something. It needs to be looked at, honestly. Whew, wow, I just want this to be resolved. And this is something we all have to resolve. Just showing you, you know, what's coming, what's going to happen, what the issue really is basically we either jump out of our cars and try to resolve the conflict, try to be peacekeepers and get sucked into the whole thing because it's all a scam. It's all a scam. These are actors. They want us to be part of it. They want us to struggle, be part of the struggle. And in fact, those jumping out of the cars are actors too. They're bit actors. This is a big production that's going on. And those streaming into the situation are actors too. Actresses. Make sure we use that term also. There's a ton of actresses involved in this. Okay, so we may need to look at the full scope of this situation. because it's really designed to dislodge spirit from reality. And it could be that everyone is actually, we're all just actors in this, actresses and actors in this. Trying to convince those who have actually accepted their holiness that they need to get involved in this too. Now, I've said this belligerency is liable to last about 4 years, I would say. Or it could be 4 decades, I'm not sure. 4 years, but there's going to be multiple uprisings of conflict. It's not going to cool down. It's like those brawls in baseball, you see, where they really go at it like cats and dogs, and they kind of separate it for a while. And then they break free and they go at it again, and they try to separate them, and they break free and go it again. You know how like a brawl gets everyone's attention. Oh my God, there's all these players stream on the field, they're brawling, they're pulling each other, they're trying to protect and pull people away, and you know, peacekeepers are in there, and then the peacekeepers get into it and they get punched and everything. And it goes on and on and on. And people are like totally mesmerized by brawls. Very much, oh, what's going on? Oh my gosh. I hope, you know. And you just have to sidestep the brawl. Don't watch the game. If there's going to be a brawl, don't watch the game. Because what is the intention of the brawl? It's to dumb down ourselves, actually. Now, we may say, well, we can't dumb ourselves down totally. So we've planned for that, where there'll be some aspect which doesn't seem to be so involved in it. And they kind of say, yeah, I'm not that into it. So we're trying to give an option to ourselves, saying, well, you don't have to be totally into it. You just have to be not into holiness. So the actors and actresses in this, the scripts are there. And what it's all about is avoiding acceptance of holiness. That is really what the whole, that's what all the time is involved with, entirely. There is no other purpose for time. This is the purpose we have given time. Now, God can give a different purpose, which is simply get used to holiness. Yeah, but there is no other purpose for time except to avoid accepting our holiness. Now this statement just hit really hard. Very positive step forward here. That's all that time is. The whole thing is just an act, a play, a scripted. You just keep scripting it. It's just a play. Designed to say is we have some option other than accepting our holiness. Time is not an option. Time is not an option. Wow, when you look at it that way, it pops for us, you know. Shakespeare had it right. I believe Shakespeare was enlightened, actually. Whoever wrote Shakespeare. And all the world is stage, just it's just all a play, much ado about nothing. That is absolutely true. And everyone is just actors and actresses upon this stage. That is entirely true. The stage of time is nothing but an act designed to distract us from accepting our holiness, accepting that we're holy. To give us this option, the option of time. So this is high spiritual discourse. You have to get, you know, on this level. Otherwise, it doesn't pop. You don't see it. Well, as soon as I said this about time, boom, I felt this reaction in me. It's like, wow, that's true. Spirit responded. Says, that's true, that is true. Spirit says, finally, yes, yes, that is true. So I'm just now remaining in this mood of repentance, of experiencing this pop, you know, of truth here. And not trying to struggle back to that clarity at this point, because I'm dealing with the reaction to it. You know, the hearing it, saying it, hearing it. We need to say it, we need to hear it, we need to say it, we need to hear it. The entire thing is nothing but actors and actresses. Acting out a supposed option to our holiness. There is no option to our holiness. It's all much ado about nothing. All of it. That means we don't need to wait for some to see how time plays out. It's all an act. Everyone's acting. There's nothing but actors and actresses here. Time is an act. So, when you reach this realization, don't try and apply it immediately, because I've tried to do that and it didn't work. You just have to let the shock wear off. Don't try to be a better actor. So, well, now I can be a great actor. Not necessarily. Because you could get caught up with those who are actors and actresses who are acting the role of just lukewarm belief in time. But that's a role too, that's an act too. That's an act that's designed to slow you down from accepting your holiness, saying, well, we don't have to be totally into conflict. Yeah, we understand that conflict's not that important. Yeah, that's an act too. So the right response is to accept your holiness now. That's the right response. That is the proper sidestepping of time. Accepting your holiness is the proper, is sidestepping time, the act of time. So my whole system is just like woo 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 reverberating now very strongly. I just saw that time is just an act. All of time is just an act. I was like, wow. that's a powerful medicine. Mm. So I'm just showcasing here this live, real-time experience. It's helpful, I believe, for people to realize that they can do it too. It's not something in a book, and it's not something that some great teacher does. It's something we do. We have to do it. We have to recognize. We have to look. We have to recognize. We have to absorb the shock. So we have to say, well, I'm not an actor, an actress in this act of time. No. I'm not involved in the act of time. Yeah, that whole revival thing might be a very clever trick, actually. Because if you see this revival, if you're driving down a highway and you don't supposedly know, but up ahead, a couple miles, there's this terrible conflict taking place outside of the road, and you're headed towards it, and you see this beautiful parade of holiness coming towards you down the road. Now, you may think, oh, people will say, oh, I'm going to just stop my car here and join this. Okay, that's what you think would happen. But what actually is likely to happen is the people will say, oh my gosh, wow, this road must be really leading to something. Wow, I want to get to the end of this line of this parade. I want to go down this road here. And see, wow, where is this parade coming from? Wow, what's going on that's so great? There's this parade. And then you'll actually end up coming upon the conflict and then saying, oh, gee, I need to stop. I need to be the heroine or hero and stop this conflict. So it may be an excuse that people want to have. They say, oh, no, I was tricked into it. I thought there was this, holiness there. I was tricked into it. They want to say that. Why else would they be going down this road at this time? Have to be going through that conflict, and they may want to justify it ahead of time by having an actor play this role, or an actress play a role of holiness in a parade sort of thing, like a revival sort of thing, to justify them leaving home and say, no, I need to go down this road. I'm only going there to see this holiness. No, they're using that as an excuse to believe in a separate will, and then so they can then come across this conflict. That's very possible. And that those who are in on this prank, who want to leave the option of holiness where it is, in reality, who want an excuse, and they don't want to seem too stupid at first. They say, no, I'm not stupid. I'm just see something very holy there. I want to go to that parade there. But actually, it's scripted that then that'll bring them across this conflict. And they say, oh my gosh, it's terrible. I see there is conflict here. And that's a very sneaky thing. In other words, it's very high intelligence plotting its own stupidity in a very sneaky way. Now, if they don't come across that revival, they may start saying, wait a minute, this isn't working out the way I thought it would. I think I'm being exposed. I think I'm appearing to be stupid. I'm not this stupid. I don't want to be seen as this stupid. Then I start to worry, and then they turn to the Holy Spirit, which is what really has to happen. Kind of back away from it. It buys some time to realize that time is just an act. It buys some time for people. So in other words, if I don't fulfill the acting role that I was given by Spirit, told I was to be a hero, that would help everyone. And if I don't fulfill that, then what's going to happen is people will say, oh, wait a minute, there's something missing here. Something's not right. We better rethink this. And then that gives the Holy Spirit some room to say, hey, you know, let's rethink this. Yeah, let's rethink this, and let's actually use some real intelligence to rethink this. What's actually going on here? Why was the actor missing? You thought for sure they'd be there. You planned it out so well, but they're missing. Why? They're gonna think that. Why is he missing? How's that possible? We had it planned out so well, we're so smart. But maybe we're trying to outsmart ourselves into stupidity, thinking we can be stupid. Maybe we're smarter than, maybe we can't be stupid. Maybe someone got wise to it. You know, all these thoughts may come up. Very interesting. So maybe by going missing as far as your role goes, you actually are doing the greatest help possible for everybody. And the truth is, I have been backing away from my role. I know what my role was. I was totally geared up for it. I was trained for it by the goddess, the muse, you know, whose part is this entertainment, parade, decoration, make it look all lovely and beautiful. And you know, I was totally trained for that. And then I started backing off of it and saying, oh, wait a minute. There's something fishy here, and now I may be seeing what's going, actually the big picture of the whole thing. Of course, we can't outsmart God, and so when someone's missing from their role, we'll say, wait a minute, I thought we had it all planned out perfectly. Why is there something missing? And then the Holy Spirit may say, well, maybe it's not God's will, you see. Maybe you can't outsmart God. And then they'll start thinking. You know, they'll start saying, wow, what's going on here? It breaks the flow of the action when some key component is missing. Now, I was designed to be part of this key component of this great revival in the world. I was trained to be, you know, a key component of that. And now I'm saying, no. I'm backing away from it. And of course, there's this like pressure to fulfill that role. Because they say, if you don't fulfill that role, the action can't flow properly. Well, that's good. That's good. Because then your own acting will feel awkward. You're like, wait a minute. I can't, my role isn't working so good. Everyone will think, wait, our roles are not working so good. And then actually the whole thing, the whole conflict will subside sooner if key components are missing from the play. So it's good if I'm missing from it, because I had a sort of key role, a certain key role in part of it, part of the acting. Entertainer, this big shot spiritual entertainer that it was just seemed to, you know, just music is flowing and beautiful, spirituality is flowing and all this kind of stuff. And if that's missing, then everybody's going to say, oh, wait a minute. And the people that are supposed to show up with all this spiritual enthusiasm at the scene of the conflict, only to then, you know, fan the flames, pour gasoline on it, as it were, of delusion. They're going to arrive there like, kind of like dispirited and say, well, I'm not feeling it. I'm not feeling it. And everybody else will say, hey, we're not feeling it either. And then the actor's belligerence will say, hey, if you're not feeling it, you know, why should we be knocking ourselves out, putting on this show for you? Maybe everything, we just need, everything needs to, like, we need to rethink this. It didn't quite work out good. It's like a theatrical play that just goes flat for some reason. It goes flat. I remember when I was younger, there was somebody who wanted to put on this big production, and it was a lady in high school. And I was this musician, had a band and stuff, and she recruited me to be the headliner. And really, you know, seduced me into it. I didn't want to. And so the band actually got, because I didn't really want to do it, it was disjointed, and it was a flop. I completely flopped. Totally flopped. The whole thing was a flop, because our hearts were not really into it. And so it was an extreme embarrassment to everybody. And the whole thing just, you know, all the air came out of the balloon. But I always felt so ashamed, like, wow. I went on stage and I was a complete flop. I know what it's like to totally flop on stage. Big audience there, tickets were sold, everything. Band was a total flop, and I was the headliner. I was the front man for the band. That's my role, is to be the front man for the band, for the spiritual band. You see, bands need a front person, right? The front person is the one that smooths everything over, no matter what's happening. You know, they're full of so much good cheer, and they can entertain so well, and they can, you know, carry the whole thing. When the audience starts to sag, the front person puts on a really big show right then, you know, and the audience's, the interest returns. Yeah. So my role was to be, you know, the front man for that. And if the front man doesn't show up, the band just says, hey, we can't play. You know, we can't play because it's gonna be flat. We're gonna embarrass ourselves. Or they may play, but it's very interesting, because I went to see George Jones, who's the ultimate front man, one of the ultimate front men, because he could make the worst bands sound, nobody cares, sound great. Nobody cares, because he's so good at singing. And I went to see him, and he had laryngitis, couldn't sing at all. And so his band ended up having to entertain us, and half the audience left. I went through this incredible experience. It was up in Oakland, California. And there was all this super hip audience there. I mean, George Jones was like, is the hippest person in music, you know, at that time. He passed on now, but all these young people there, old people, young people, because they realized this guy is a total legend. And so they were there because this is totally hip. He hadn't been out on the West Coast for a long time. We thought maybe it's his last time. And so there's always super sophisticated, artistic people. I couldn't believe the audience. I couldn't believe it. I was just like looking at these people just saying, what? You know, who are these people? Super, you know, metrosexual, sophisticated people that are like, this is the scene, you know. This was an artiste scene to be there. And so Jones, the warm-up band started and played some songs. Everybody was saying, okay, all right, here we go. Everyone was totally into it. And, you know, he didn't come out. And they played another song. And people started grumbling, like, what's going on? Where is he? People said, hey, you know, where's Jones? And then finally the lady who was fronting for Jones, who was trying to keep the audience, this lady singer who was like his backup singer, said, we're having a little difficulty. He's almost ready, though. And so this went on and on and on, and finally the audience started almost rioting, saying, hey, you know, what's going on? We're being scammed. And finally Jones came out and started singing. Everyone's, all right. And then people started saying, looking at each other, say, what's going on? Because his voice wasn't right. It was raspy. And murmuring, everyone was murmuring. The whole audience was murmuring. And it was just quiet spread throughout the whole place. And then he says, you know, I got a little problem with my throat, but I'm trying to work it out. And we said, okay. So everyone's like standing up, standing ovation, cheering. Come on, you can do it, you can do it, you can do it. And then he kept getting worse. And people start booing him, you know, booing. So half the crowd was cheering, half the crowd was booing. It was the most amazing concert you can imagine. There's nothing like it. And so half of you said, no, George, you can do it. And the other half screaming, we want our money back. So people start chanting, we want our money back. Half the crowd was really mad. Half the crowd was super supportive. And so you had this big conflict in the crowd taking place, actually. And I was, of course, supporting him, saying, no, it's okay, you can do it. And so you had half the crowd, and then half the crowd got up and left. And the other crowd half stayed. But the crowd that left was buzzing. They stayed in the lobby, and everyone was angry and upset, and it was weird. And eventually he said, I'm sorry, I can't do it. Can't do it. I'll come back. He said, I'll come back and make it up for you. He never came back. He's passed on now. And the people were banging on the box office window and demanding their money back. It was almost a near riot, actually. All these sophisticated, you know, yuppie, hip artistic types and druggies and everything was there, you know, the whole scene. And they were, you know, they didn't get their show, you know. So I think maybe this was a tip-off for me, is that no matter what a great front person you may be, you can come down with this laryngitis. And as my voice is starting to go right now, and the crowd that you think is with you will turn on you. And again, you get half and half, half turn, half don't, and then you get this conflict, actually. And it becomes a very, very unpleasant situation. So it's better not to even be a front person, no matter how great you may think you could be. That's a lesson that was shown to me. Because really, Jones was bred to be a front man, singing for his dad, who was a raging, abusive alcoholic, would come home and beat the kids. And he was the only one that could stop this by singing so great. And so people believed that if he was there singing, everybody would drop whatever the conflicts they had just to listen to him, which was true, basically. Go to these honky-tonks, you know, and people were fighting. He just singing where bars, people were fighting, terrible fighting down there in the oil country of Beaumont, Texas area, and stuff, and a rough, tough honky-tonk place. And he'd hold the crowd. So he was this ultimate front man, really. And I was actually trained to be like that. I was trained to listen to Jones and try to sing like it and say, this is how you can be like this. You can be that good as a front person. But the Holy Spirit's saying, oh, wait a minute, you know, you need to look at this. Look at this. Wait a minute. Yeah, I got some wisdom here. And of course, he needed to drink like crazy. And ultimately, they got him on cocaine to be this front person, because it wore him out. Because in order to be this front person, you have to just absolutely put on this incredible scintillation, really, of tugging on people's attention. And it just utterly wears you out. You have to let go of all inhibitions and even all concern for your own health, actually, to put on this tremendous show, just to sing your heart out. You got to sing your heart out. And again, you have to not even be concerned. So he drank, he got himself so drunk, so he was not even thinking about his own health. his own energy, you know, anything, nothing like that. It was only just to totally sing his heart out with no inhibition. And people would say, oh my God, this is a great. But he you know, ended up 90 pounds in a mental hospital. He just had the most incredible suffering because it just wore him out. So there's no question that my role was to be the super front man coming into this world. There's no question about it. My entire life was nothing but training to be this way. Except the Holy Spirit was tipping me off to this. Wow. And now I'm seeing it. You got to bring these things to light. What is your role in this play? You see, what is your role? Examine your role, and if you don't play that role, you're actually helping everybody out. Time is nothing but a useless act of an excuse to avoid accepting our holiness. Not that we can't accept it, we already have it, but it's to avoid acknowledging it. You know, we can refuse to acknowledge it. We do have that. We have free will in that we can be whimsical if we want to. God doesn't force us to know that we don't have a separate will. We can be whimsical if we want to. So time is just nothing but whimsicality. It's just an act. So if you don't fulfill your role in this play, the whole play seems to be less interesting, which is a good thing. Which is a good thing. Less compelling, which is a very good thing. Now, what would probably happen is if I'm leading this parade as a front man towards back to heavens, the kingdom of heaven, supposedly, people coming down the road away from that, they'll say, oh my God, you're so wonderful. And they'd all join with you. And you think you have this big audience. And you think, oh, I'm so wonderful. And then the audience are saying, you know what? We heard that there's this terrible conflict down the road. And you know what? You're the only one that can really help. We want to help out. And you could come and bring peace to the conflict. And so what happens is the audience members start lobbying you, saying, please, praying to you. So you got to do this for us. This, you know, this is God's will. We know it is. And then they'll turn you around, and then you'll go back down the road to the conflict, believing that you got the power to turn this audience that's at the conflict, turn them away from it. When in fact, what happens is you get this oil and water mixture, which ends up contaminating the whole thing. Those who feel they're very spiritual will end up feeling like, wow, what a bummer, what a terrible situation, you know, this didn't work out, you weren't able to hold this audience, you know, wow, I'm so disillusioned in you and stuff. And it'll devastate me, and the whole thing will end up having this very bad conclusion to it all. Waste of time. And that those aspects of spirit that had scripted this as a clever way to leave heaven, as it were, to refuse to acknowledge their holiness, to leave that acknowledgement, as it were. Well, it has to do with time, but it seems a very smooth, clever segue away from reality, you know. They will feel like it didn't work. There's a continuity issue that to try and leave. Remember, if we want to try to leave reality, we're going to feel there's a severe continuity issue with that. So we try to script a way to make it all seem legitimate and justified. So if we don't play our role in that, then they feel, whoa, this is a bumpy ride. I don't like this. You know, there's something wrong with all this. That's good for them. Helps save time. Helps bring the ultimate conclusion to time, which is to realize time is just an act designed to provide a so-called option to accepting our holiness. There is no option for us accepting our holiness. We are holy because God gave us the gift of holiness in time. See, holiness applies to time. It's the resolution to time. It's the option that we have. It's the gift that we have, which enables us to set time down. It's all one. It's the gift that God gave us that enables us to set time down right now. Always right now. And so, since God has given us this gift, we don't have any other option. We don't have an option to reject this gift. We have it. So we have the capacity to set time down. We have that capacity. Time is this act that says there's an option to reality. There's another will, you know, and we have now the gift to set this down. So we'll always have that gift. So why not use it now? It's totally applicable now. So the sooner we all realize, wait a minute, that this whole time act is bumpy, and there was missing players, missing actors. Where'd they go? What happened to them? What happened to them? Maybe the Malaysian plane is something to do with this. People suddenly go missing, you know, missing actors. They're not playing the roles that we expected them to play. I don't know. What happened? We need to find that black box, find out what happened. People are all thinking now, you know, wow. What if things don't go as we scripted them? What if our, you know, that's big help. That's the Holy Spirit is helping certain actors not show up. The front man doesn't show up for the band, then maybe the band will start saying, wait a minute, we're not gonna go play for this conflict that's going on there. We don't have our front man. We can't do that. Without our front man, how can we do that? So maybe they're all depending on me not to show up, you know, the band. Because the band probably doesn't want to play. But if the front man shows up and they say, hey everybody, come on, we gotta do this, and they'll say, oh, okay, all right, yeah, I guess we can do it. No front man, the band might say forget it. If the band says forget it, those that want to use the band as an excuse to say, hey look, we can put on this really great show for these people who are in conflict and bring them out of it, they might say, wait a minute, we can't do that. There's no band. We can't go back to the conflict. And they might say, wait a minute, just a minute here. Let me give this a second thought here. Let me rethink this whole thing. See? Saving a lot of delay that way. Because it's really, the whole thing is just Spirit saying, look how stupid I can be. I bet you I can be so totally stupid. I'm so smart I can be stupid. There isn't any such smarts that we can be stupid. Reality is reality. Truth is true. It's not a question of smartness. There is no truth that can be untrue. There isn't any such thing. So there isn't any actual stupidity. There isn't any actual intelligence that can be non-intelligent. So again, time is a waste of time. Now we might be saying, well, that proves that we're not smart enough. There's no such thing as being smart enough. It's like saying we're not smart enough to do the impossible. But we are smart. We are smart enough to recognize that that is whim. It has nothing to do with intelligence. It's a whim. We just think we can dress whim up to make it seem real. You know, we're so smart we should be able to dress whim up to make it look real. No, we can never do that. It can superficially, in a glittery tinsel way, distract us for a bit or something, but it can never compete with reality. There is no intelligence that can compete with reality. Reality did not create, it is not a creation to compete with itself. So it's perfect. How can you compete with perfection? You cannot. So reality is not something that can be competed with. That's why I always say to the goddess, you can't afford me. Goddess is the our belief we can dress up whim, decorate, accessorize, dress up, fashion it, that it seems to compete with reality. This idea of this play we're in, that we're somehow competing with reality. There's some separate will that's competing for our attention, and we're trying to, we're saying, boo, 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 hiss, hiss, you're not as good as reality. There is no competition. So the whole belief that there's a competition in good and evil, that is the whim. Since reality is entirely perfect, the notion of a competition is a whim. So this whole idea that there's some evil competing with the good is whim. That's our delusion. And the idea that we need to tip the scales in favor of good, and we need a band with a front man that can come there and convince everybody that the good really is good and the bad really is bad. That's the delusion. That's not enlightenment. That's why Jesus rebuked people and they called them good. Oh, you're here, you represent the good. He said, no, don't call me good. I do not represent the good. That's delusion. I represent truth. The whole idea that there could be some separate will competing with reality for our attention, and what we call, well, that's evil. And then we can defeat that will and then go back to reality and say, well, reality is now real, but because we love reality, because we were able to defeat evil, that it tried to, there was some other option, but we said, God, we love you so much that we rejected that other option, we defeated that other option. That is whim. That's what we have to laugh about as whim. There isn't any other option to perfection. Perfection does not allow for another option. That's what we're not getting. That's the whimsical part of the situation. It's like we're saying, well, there was this other option that could actually, what we're really saying is there is another option, another will, and that is actually more attractive than reality. But because we love God and are so loyal to God, we rejected it and we destroyed it, so we'll never be tempted again. We won't never be tempted by it. And aren't we great, God? Don't we love you so much? That's when. That's the delusion. That is it. That is it. So let's go over that again. We're saying, God, there is this other will. It came to me. Like we're with God, and we say, hey, God, you know, this other will came to me the other day, and it's actually more attractive than reality. And it's like, I said, wow. But I said, you know what? How evil it is to try and to tempt me away from God. You know, I say, God, they're trying to tempt me away, and I feel powerless. I feel helpless to, with this superior attraction. I just can't resist it. But you know, God, I'm going to fight against it. I'm really going to fight against it. It might take me a long time to defeat this, but because I love you so much, for creating me, I am going to fight and fight and fight against this, and I'm eventually going to defeat it. You just wait and see. That's what we're saying to God. That's what we're saying to God, and God is just laughing. You know, we're making this up. We're pranking ourselves. We're just projecting our own perfection as if it were a separate will, and then claiming it's more attractive, you see. And then claiming we're going to spend all this time, we need all this time to defeat it. This is just a prank on ourselves. So again, now this is bringing up so much light into the situation that it's, at some point you're just like, wow. So we think that the resolution is we finally go back home and say, God, I'm back home and I was able to defeat that more attractive will and it's destroyed forever. So I'll never leave you again. Don't worry. Is that the resolution? No, we never admitted that we were pranking ourselves. We never admitted that it's just a whim. We never admitted it was just our own projection. So there's nothing to resolve, because we could easily just do it again and run the whole prank again. There's no true repentance at all. True repentance is to say, God, there never was any separate will. I just made it up. It was my own projection. I didn't need it to defeat anything, because there isn't any competition to your perfection. I didn't need any time to struggle and try to defeat this imaginary evil will. There never was any. It was all a prank. I was just pranking myself just to see if I could. Then that's when you're really home. That's when God says, well done, well done. The other, God says, just cannot say anything to you, because you're trying to establish that there was a separate will, but you had some power then to defeat it. God said, I didn't create any separate will. There's no such thing. You're still entirely unrepentant. So we keep using time. Say, well, God's just not accepting our repentance. No, we're not repentant. We're not repentant. And there's so many people here in the world, what I see is they think they're repentant. And they said, God, look at how I spent my time. I'm on the side of good. I'm defeating evil. I'm showing how much I love you. How come you don't accept my repentance? And they're like, they're all upset, you know, at God. Like, are they, they're, you know, they're just, they got this feeling like, what's wrong? Something's wrong. I don't feel God quite accepts me. You know, God doesn't accept me. Maybe, you know, maybe something's happened to God. Maybe God's changed. No, we're not repentant. Is the problem. We're not repentant. I see the people in the world of this world thinking they're repentant. They're not repentant. So they just want to scam God, keep trying to scam God with this act of time. They say, okay, well, maybe God, maybe I haven't quite defeated it yet. That's why. And that's, what else can they think, right? So they say, okay, let's have a final battle now. And then that draws the enemy to them, of course, and there's this conflict. These are actors, this and that. Those who want to con God into thinking that, you know, we've defeated some separate will, they need the good and the bad. They need this play to take place. So they get arranged for actors to do this, and they're the audience. And they said, yeah, I was on the side of the good. I was there when good defeated evil, God. So now you can see that I'm truly repentant, that I'm ready to return home. And, of course, nothing happens. They say, uh-oh. I didn't quite defeat it. Then do it again. Do it again. Do it again. Over and over. That is not repentance. So all I'm doing is I'm pointing out what's real repentance, so you can contrast the two. Contrast the two. And you realize, it's all a play. It's all an act. I'm still trying to con God. Still trying to prank myself into claiming that I can create something better in reality. And that this is not me, it's a separate will, you see. I'm just being attracted to it. And then realizing, oh no, I really love God. Even though this is better, I'm going to defeat this. And then return home, and God will say, what an incredible creation I made. That it was faced with something even better, and it decided, no, I don't want that. And God will be saying, thank you so much for not leaving me, you know. So God's the needy one now. Like, you didn't leave me. But we've turned the tables on God at that point, right? Because now God lives in fear that you might someday leave for this bit more attractiveness, greater attractiveness, because you have the capacity to create it, huh? And so then God now is in a needy, dependent position upon you. See, we're trying to turn the tables, and God knows that. God is not fooled by this whole thing. So all this false repentance is an attempt to turn the tables on God, actually. And God's not fooled. So we just keep this act of time going, uselessly. Until we truly repent. Say, God, this is all a trick. I was trying to trick you. Just to see if I could. I was really trying to trick myself, you know. Just think, can I do this? Can I imagine a creation better than this and then claim it comes from somewhere else? It's just a prank. It's just a prank. And this is true repentance. This is true. And then God says, exactly, you got it. And then you can accept God as it is, as the prime creator. And not dependent on your deciding not to project again. That you're the one who's repented. You know, not that God's accepted that, well, you realize you won't do it again. That create the superior reality. You won't do it again. You decide you won't do it again, but you could. You know, that kind of, the capability to do it is there. You just either said you won't do it. That's not repentance. Repentance is to say, no, I never had any such capability. I never will. And then God says, welcome to the kingdom. It's all yours. It's all yours. See? It is tricky. We've scripted a tricky script, haven't we? But if we see it and just look at it, we realize it's not so tricky. I mean, we can say, okay. And people are saying, if you don't show up as a front man, we can't repent, and we'll never be saved. You're ruining our salvation. No, that's not true at all. Helping the salvation. By, you know, you get into this mood like, my repentance is not working. And then you get scared, of course. And then you turn to the Holy Spirit. And then the Holy Spirit says, don't worry. Don't worry. You know exactly what I'm doing. Easy for you to understand what's going on. Just start listening to me, finally. What people with false repentance have done is they're saying, as soon as you accept my repentance, God, then I will, they say to God, God, the Holy Spirit is telling me to do the repentance this way. And as soon as you accept it, then you'll realize this is so. The Holy Spirit is not telling them to repent that way. They are just making that up. They're just making that up. And then what they're saying is, well, once God realizes that this is the right repentance, then there's no choice but to accept that this, the Holy Spirit must have taught me this. Must have taught me this. So we steal the Holy Spirit away from God too. You know, that whole thing. It's all this prank that we're playing. So I pray that as a front man, I don't show up at all. Therefore the band decides that they're not going to show up either. Therefore the audience decides they're not going to show up either. Therefore, the belligerents decide that their whole act is really not playing very well. Didn't really reach its objective. And so everybody starts giving up on this false repentance. That's what has to happen. Because there is this massive false repentance belief system in the world here. And they're trying to empower it. They're trying to empower it even more. It'll never work. And eventually, you have to turn to the Holy Spirit and actually ask for the real story. Instead of dictating to what you think the Holy Spirit should be saying, which is to support your false repentance. See, we have this premise that this false repentance is it. Therefore, we think the Holy Spirit must support it. So therefore, we think, well, this is what the Holy Spirit must be telling us. We don't even have to listen to it because we already know what it has to say, that this is the way. We don't even listen to it. That's what I get. I don't think most people in the world, even who say they're listening to the Holy Spirit, I don't think they even listen to it at all. Not really listening to it. They just say, we already know what it must be saying because we know it must be in support of this repentance. So what we already know, why waste time listening to it? That's what happens here. That's what happens. So you have to admit that all the training you did was a waste of time. But, you know, that's necessary to recognize that. Literally, my whole life was just preparing to be a front man at a certain time in history, preparing to be the right kind of front man, and just preparing for that, waiting. Now I see, no, that's not it. That's wrong. Just don't show up at all. But that's okay because, you know, you have to go through that before it dawns upon you, wait a minute. So it's actually the greatest thing ever. It is time you spend having it dawn upon you that the role that you're supposedly playing, you're not supposed to play that role. Drop it. And then you see the whole scam, the overall scam for what it is, the whole prank, really. You can't even call it a scam because God, you can't scam God. So it's just really we're playing a prank on ourselves is all that it really is. Then you begin to see that. And so that is really the coolest thing ever. It really is. It's more cool than being a front person. I'll tell you that. It's more cool than that. I can be the greatest front person there ever was. But yet what I'm going through this is way cooler for me than being that great front person. Way better. Way more compelling. Way more compelling. You can't even compare it really. This is what's really cool, is don't show up, don't play your role. That's the ultimate in cool. That's the ultimate in hip, because you're hip to truth, finally. And that's not an act. It's not being an act, which is what is really cool. Not playing a role, that is what is the best role of all. It's not playing a role. So, how that's done, I'll find out. Find out. But this is just, you know, blowing the doors off of the whole thing. It's just like, it's an astonishment, but it's very clear and just another simple step from where we've been previously. But yeah, it's such a big picture. It's tremendous. Whew. And let this sink in. Don't struggle with it. Now, of course, the role of front person will go to some understudy or something, right? And so you have to sit there and watch and say, oh my God, I could have done that better. Could have done that a lot better. And that's what I feel in life. I look at all these actors in the world. I just say, oh my God, I could do that so much better. Be way better than that. That's the price you pay. I mean, that's the burden you have to have. It is, let these understudies do it if they want to do it, if they want to. Because the whole thing will be flat because of it, you know. And of course, the audience tries even harder to get into it. And you realize it's all forced. It's all forced, you know. The emotion's not really there. It's not really, you know, they're just like, I'm kind of getting bored about this whole thing. And you realize I could have done a lot better job. But of course, I would have completely burned myself out. And, you know, it made the whole thing worse. The whole false repentance thing would have been worse. Worse. So, but that's the having to just, and maybe it's better not even be here to see the understudy front person, you know, because you might think, wow, they're really struggling. Maybe if I help them out, or, oh gosh, I should be doing that. I could do it better, you know, all that stuff. Maybe that temptation is too much. Maybe avoid that temptation altogether. Is not a bad idea for me. It's not a bad idea for me, actually. It's probably a very good idea. Because I'm kind of in a somewhat, you know, unique position of being a front person for a band. There may be a lot of bands probably, you know, but you know, we, you know, like let's say there's like a number of like really top headliner bands, and you're supposed to be the front person for one of those bands. There's not a whole lot of people like that who have trained for that, and so they're in a kind of vulnerable position actually, because they hate to see the show flop. I mean, like if the success of the whole show, they're trained to make it depend on them. Fail. Yeah, I really do. I hate to see failure. And always, whenever I see some problem, I want to go in and make it so it doesn't fail. say, wow, let's just, hey, you know, let's not fail. So it may be like very difficult for a front person to be around the situation, see their understudy, and seeing a flop. You know, it's just like, you know, really inbred into me, like, you just don't want it to flop, even though it's supposed to flop. Because I'm just like trained to not let it flop. And the training is very severe. You know, training to be a hero, training to be a front man. So the heroes, those are trained to play the role, the hero, the front man, who keeps it, the show from flopping, saves the show. You know, comes in, the show's like sagging, or like, let's say there's a concert, and there's all these warm-up bands, you know, and there's a headliner. And so the crowd is like tired of these warm-up bands, like they're kind of, oh man, what is this? I'm going to leave, you know. But they stay there because they know this headliner band is just going to rock. Absolutely just, I mean, I could do it too. I can hear in my mind, like music, like blue, for instance, bluegrass. I go to a bluegrass festival and absolutely knock it out of the park. Okay, someone's coming. I'm going to end the video now. This is great progress we made, isn't it? All right, that's it.